Welcome to Sunday morning worship at Buckhurst Hill Baptist Church. We look forward to seeing how the Lord is going to be working in our service today. We're going to open today's service with some notices. God bless you all.
Your love is taking over me, broke me from my chains and set me free. Mercy came and died for me, now I stand in grace and have been redeemed. You're breathing in new life in me, taking all my shame and my fears released. You're the only one for me. Your victory's alive and it reigns in me. The cross has won, death overcome, we are free. In Jesus' name we stand and we say, all my shame and my fears released. You're the only one for me. Your victory's alive and it reigns in me. The cross has won, death overcome, we are free. In Jesus' name we stand and we say,
welcome to Buckhurst Hill Baptist Church. So good to have you with us this morning. The cross has won and we are free in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, it's awesome to gather together as God's people this morning. It is so good to see so many, live and right here in the sanctuary with your masks on and social distancing. It's all very good, and a big welcome to everyone watching online on our YouTube channel this morning. And this morning is all about God's love reigning in our hearts so that we can overcome our past in Jesus' name. And right from the outset, we declare the victory that Jesus has and the destiny that Christ has for every life in Jesus' name. So very good morning to you and welcome to BHBC.
Welcome to our online service, those watching online, and welcome to those in the sanctuary. We pray that you are blessed this morning. I love that scripture that says, I was glad when they said to me, let's go to the house of the Lord. Who's glad this morning?
Yes.
Amen. Who's glad online? Amen. I was glad when they said unto me, let's go to the house of the Lord. Let us rejoice and be glad in him.
Amen.
Amen. And thank you for the cross of Jesus that has set us free. I'm going to read to you a scripture, 1 Peter 2, verse 9, and it says, "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." Amen? Amen. And I love that part where it says, we need to proclaim, because God has brought us out of darkness. And you know, I know we are gathered here together. The Bible says that God commands a blessing where there is unity. And I know that we all agree in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's pray together.
Hallelujah. Let's pray.
Father, we thank you for your marvelous light. And thank you, Lord, for taking us out of darkness. Thank you for Jesus that has set us free. His blood has set us free, and we are free indeed. And I pray, Father, for every person this morning, Lord, that you would touch their lives and that you would just bring down heaven and open heaven over every heart, over every life, and over every home. We pray this in your mighty name. Amen.
Amen. You know, no matter what we're going through this morning, no matter where you find yourself at, and this is for all of us here in the sanctuary, we all masked up. At home, you can be singing quite freely. Yeah, we masked up. But whatever we're going through, we can worship the one who is the giver of life. You know, we don't need a good day to worship. We don't need a bad day to worship. We don't need to feel like worshiping to worship. God is looking for worshipers. He's seeking for worshipers who will worship him in spirit and in truth. So whatever you're going through, wherever you find yourself in life, the one thing you can do in every circumstance and at any time is to praise, and that's then called a sacrifice of praise, and it's to worship the one who sets the captives free. Well, are you ready to worship this morning here in the sanctuary? Amen. At home, we trust you're ready to worship as well. Ruby, our daughter's going to be leading worship this morning with the worship team. So let's worship the Lord this morning.
Oh,
Thank you for your sweet presence, Lord, in this place today. Holy Spirit, would you come right now and be at work in every heart, and in every life. Would you come and flow? Would you come and work? Would you come and bring comfort? Would you come and bring strength? Hallelujah. And thank you, Father, for that certain hope that Jesus is returning.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Church, Jesus is returning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. I'm excited for the return of the Lord. Amen. He's going to return in robes of white. And for endless days, we will praise Him.
Amen.
So we must never stop now. Let's keep praising Him. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Let's praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
We praise you, Jesus. We glorify you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, how beautiful it is to worship together.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
We serve a mighty God, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Amen. Kevin's going to lead us in a prayer now.
Let's pray together this morning, church. You may have pressing needs this morning in your own life, for those here in person in the sanctuary. Maybe you're going through something. This is your moment in the service where you can offer that before the Lord. Of course, you can offer it to Him at any time, but we make this moment in the service for you to bring your needs, the needs of your world, before the Lord. And for you at home as well today, this is your moment, your needs, your family needs, those things pressing on you. Maybe you received an emergency family phone call that has upset you. Maybe something's going on and it's kind of running, the tape's playing in the back of your mind all the time. This is the moment to give that to the Lord. To give that to the Lord and to know that He is mighty to save. Hallelujah. So let's do that now. I'm going to hand over to you to be lifting your world before the Lord right now. Then after that, I'll lead us in a time of corporate prayer together.
Psalm 97 verse 5 says, the mountains melt like wax before the Lord of all the earth. The heavens proclaim His righteousness, and all the people see His glory.
Hallelujah. May your mountains melt like wax. May you declare His glory. In Jesus' name, let it be done, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We're going to pray now for our country. As more of the lockdown rules get eased tomorrow, I want to pray for, you know, wisdom for the politicians. We also think of the royal family this Sunday with the passing, the sad passing of Prince Philip. We pray God's grace and His peace and His strength to the Queen. To the royal family. We think of schools, many holidays ending tomorrow, schools going back, businesses going back, life starting to open up again. There's a sense of excitement, there's a sense of nervousness amongst many. We just pray God's protection over us as a nation. So Lord, we take this moment as your people to intercede on behalf of our nation. We pray, Lord, first of all, that this nation will return to you, Lord, on a mass scale. Hearts returning to you. As lockdown restrictions ease more tomorrow, we pray, Lord, for your sense of peace, your calm, your protection. We pray that your healing ultimately would rain down. Lord, we want to lift the royal family. We want to lift the Queen before you now, Lord, on the sad news, Lord, of the passing of Prince Philip. And we pray, Lord, that you would strengthen the Queen and the royal family. Let them know your peace. Let them know your presence. Lord, would you minister to them? And as a nation, Lord, as the funeral is televised next Saturday, I pray, Lord, that your peace would rest and reign upon this nation, upon the Commonwealth, and upon the nations of the world. Now, Lord, we look to you. We want to pray for the church. We want to pray for the church locally. We want to pray for the church nationally. And we want to pray for the church globally. Lord, that we would be everything that you have called us to be, that your purpose for the church will be unstoppable, Lord. And Lord, that the church would arise in the power and the strength of Christ, that the church would arise in the power and the strength of the Spirit, that the church would arise in the authority of you, Almighty God, and be a voice to the nation, be a voice to the nations of the world, and be a place, Lord, where people's lives are saved, restored, healed, and set free. And we continue, Lord, to trust you and to cry out for revival. We pray for revival, Lord. Worldwide revival. Come and light your Holy Spirit flame, Lord. Come and light your Holy Spirit flame, Lord. Si ki ta da da ba si ki ta da da ba ki si ta da 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 ba si ki ta da da ba si ki ti si ta da ba sandi. Lord, come and light your Spirit's flame, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Beautiful to worship together. I trust you just experiencing and enjoying the presence of the Lord. I don't know about you, but last Sunday and even right now, it feels like we're experiencing just a little slice of eternity here. His presence is awesome. Receive. I want to encourage you this morning. Receive everything God has for you. And be everything he has called you to be in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Let's just continue receiving as we continue with the service. Everything we do is worship. And even the next part of our service is worship to the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Yes, God's presence is really here with us. So we just want to take that moment just to be in his presence. Amen. No, nothing can stop God's people. The Bible says no weapon formed against us will prosper. Amen. God has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. We are free. And he wants us to proclaim it on the rooftops, wherever we go, that he has set us free. Amen. All right, we come to an exciting part of our service as well as part of our worship to the Lord. We're going to focus around our giving, and here to do that is Tony. He's going to be on screen.
So let's welcome Tony.
Good morning. As we begin to meet together in person once again, it made me think about the story of Noah coming out of the ark. Here is a well-known passage from Genesis chapter 8. So Noah came out together with his sons and his wife and his sons' wives. All the animals and all the creatures that move along the ground and all the birds, everything that moves on land, came out of the ark, one kind after another. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of all the clean animals and clean birds, he sacrificed burnt offerings on it. notes that when Noah came out of the ark after more than a year of the flood, the first thing that he did was to give a sacrifice to God, an offering of thanksgiving for the safekeeping of himself and his family. And I thought that was appropriate for where we are today. So can I encourage you to continue with your weekly and monthly offerings, and you can give online. Let's give thanks to God for looking after us so well during this difficult time.
Oh, thank you, Tony, for focusing us in and around our giving. Isn't modern technology wonderful? We've got to work out and figure out every Sunday, just like the seating arrangement gets figured out. We've also got to figure out our arrangement up here. And only a certain amount of people can fit in with all the spacing that's required. So, Tony's big screen today. So, bless you, Tony, and what a wonderful reminder about our worship through our giving. Right now, something very exciting. We have Carly and Stacy live with us today, and they're going to be sharing the children and the youth talk to us today. So would you welcome Stacy and Carly?
Good morning, everybody. Oh, Stacey.
Oh, Carly, what's up with you this morning?
Well, to be quite honest, you've really upset me.
Really?
Yeah, really, Stacey, really. And I've composed a list of all the things that you've done to upset me. I've kept a record.
What?
2 weeks ago, you said that you were going to wash my yellow t-shirt and you didn't. 3 weeks ago, you lost a pair of my jeans. 4 years ago, you were supposed to meet me and you were late.
4 years ago? I'm not being... Well, hang on a minute. I've actually here. I've actually got a list too. You're rude. Last week, we were meant to meet and go for a walk and you didn't turn... Oh, actually, you did turn up. You were like really late. And to make matters worse, you had this round your house and I found it.
Yes, but that was my yellow spade.
This is my yellow spade.
I bought it 2007.
Lies.
You obviously stole it from me at some point. I'm not sure when.
That is not true.
Well, I've had enough of you.
Oh, I've had enough of you. What is happening here? What is happening here? We've got like lists of what the other person's done to us. And, you know, it says in the Bible that we shouldn't keep a record of wrongs. And that is exactly what we're doing, aren't we?
Yes.
It's really like not right. Jesus, he says to us, like, forgive as we've been forgiven. And that is the truth. And if we're totally honest with you, even this week, like, me and Carly have had lists at one point or another.
Yes, but Stacey, I doubt anybody here struggles with unforgiveness.
Well, do you know what, Carly? I don't think that's true. I think everybody that's in relationships and friendships, maybe you at school, like we all have things that get on our nerves and, you know, can make us upset, just like we did. But, you know, what happened in that moment was we really had to sort of rise above it. I mean, like, I thought, oh, Carly's really annoying me. And then, like, all of a sudden, we both had lists, but I was like, we can't keep these lists. And what we did was, we let Jesus into our hearts. And just like it says, do you remember that story, guys, when you were in reception? That one that says, we're going on a bear hunt. And it says, you can't go over it. You can't go under it. But you've got to go through it. And that's exactly what God is asking us to do today in our hearts. We need to go through things. If someone's upset with us or we're upset with them, that's okay. That's really natural. Mm. But actually, Jesus says forgive because we've been forgiven. Don't keep a record of wrongs. Mm. So that's exactly what me and Carly did. We both spent time with Jesus. I love Carly. And actually, Jesus calls us, doesn't he, Carly?
Yes.
To actually love others like he loves us.
Yes.
Jesus didn't keep a record of our wrongs, and we all make mistakes, don't we?
Definitely. And when we think about all the things that Jesus has forgiven us for, how can we hold things against other people? Can we? No. So let's not.
Let's not.
I really forgive you.
And do you know what? I really forgive you and I love you. So guys, let's not just go over it. Let's not go under it. Let's go through it with Jesus and get him to change our hearts and fill us with his love for each other. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah.
Woo!
Amen.
Oh,
thank you, Carly and Stacey. Yet again, another encouraging talk to the youth and to the children and to all of us. Amen. Burn that list. Jesus has forgiven us. We need to forgive others. So thank you. That was amazing. Up next, Rain is going to be reading us the scripture for today. And then Kevin is going to be bringing us the sermon, Love Reigns Over the Past. Amen. What a beautiful title. I think it fits in well with what we've just heard now, that love reigns over the past. So we pray that the Lord bless you all this morning and receive the word that the Lord has given, prepared the pastor with. Just receive his word this morning and let the word of God wash over your lives today. God bless you.
Hello, and today I'm going to be reading 2 Corinthians 5, verse 16 to 21. So now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone and the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling to the world, to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them, and he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, and though God were making his appeal through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
In the pressing.
Lord, make us whatever you want us to be. Jesus, bring that new wine out of us. Thank you, Father. Amen. Thank you, worship team. Thank you to the tech team. Thank you to all the teams involved this morning, from the welcome team on the door. I trust you all received a good welcome this morning and that you were ushered to your seat. So big shout out to the welcome team. I don't know if they can hear me out there, but this one's for you. Bless you. Big shout out to the tech team. They, all the words on screen, all the sound you hear, and you know, all the mixing, the visuals and the mixing and the sound mixing that's going out on YouTube as well this morning. And you know, well done team. What a beautiful morning, you know. Great having Daniel on the drums this morning as well, you know. Great having young people up here. Great having all, can I say, all different ages up here, you know. And we're just trusting God to continue doing an awesome thing. Hallelujah. Well, you know, what I want to say to you this morning is I believe that we are living in a time in history where we need a new way of thinking. We're living in a time of history where we are not going to go back to what was once before. It's clear. Stuff that's happened all over the world. A shift. Ooh, what happened there? A shift has come all over the world. Are we not going back to what we once were? But also, we don't really know what the future holds. It's a moment in time where we're not going back, we're going forward, and we are venturing into the unknown. And that's where we have to be, that new wineskin for the new wine. That's why we need a whole new radical way of thinking, a whole new way of thinking that doesn't drag us back into old ways. You know, until we see things from God's perspective, we'll constantly make the same mistakes over and over and over again. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You kind of make the same mistake over and over, and you think, when will I ever learn? It's because God's trying to get through to us. He's trying to bring us into an alignment of a revelation of who Jesus is, and a revelation of the thoughts and the life that he wants us to live now. A revelation of what it means to be new wine, the new wine of Jesus poured into our new wine skins. We're not going to live in a patched up environment where we just patch ourselves up as a wine skin, but we're going to be new. But that's up to us. We've got to work with the Lord, you know. Until we see things from God's point of view, we'll continually make the same mistakes over and over again. We'll turn down the metaphorical dead ends. You know what I'm talking about. You just keep hitting that dead end, that same old problem, that same old situation, that same old dead end. That same financial struggle, that same thing that's been through your family line. Now, be very careful what I'm about to say right now. I feel led by the Spirit to say it, but I believe I need to be very careful. Take it in a new wine perspective, a Jesus new wine skin and a Jesus new wine perspective. Sometimes we carry things of heritage that's not of God. Sometimes we carry things of heritage that's not of God, that frames us in, that frames our thinking, that frames our world. And Jesus wants to set us free from those things. He doesn't want us making the same mistakes. He doesn't want us hitting the same dead ends over and over again. He doesn't want you to give up. I believe that's a word for someone here this morning and even online this morning. It's not time to give up. It's time to get up in Jesus' name. Get up and live the life that he has for you. You see, anyone who loses their vision for the future starts to look back. This is a common problem. amongst Christians. We get comfortable. We get comfortable in our wineskin. Our wineskin almost becomes like a pair of jeans that we want to live in all day. Does anybody have that pair of jeans? I've got that pair of jeans on right now. I call these my lockdown specials, right? Okay, it's kind of the jeans that have kind of, you know, they've kind of, you know, grown into your legs. And they've kind of stretched and, you know, expanded and contracted with you through lockdown as you've gone through the various phases of expansion and contraction during lockdown, okay? And our old wineskin is kind of like that. It's comfortable. It's the way we like to serve the Lord. It's the songs we like to sing. It's the scriptures we like to hear. Oh, it's the people we like to see at church. It's our little attitudes that we hold, which are our little golden attitudes, our little golden cups, our little golden chalices that we keep. And I love that little attitude. You know, the Lord won't mind if I don't like so-and-so. The Lord won't mind if I snub so-and-so on a Sunday. These are our old wineskins. These are the jeans that we have been living in lockdown. And it's a new day. It's a new day that's going to command a radical new thinking from the Lord, because we're going forward. God is going to navigate in and through His church a whole new way forward for the church, and I even believe for society, in Jesus' name. So anyone who loses vision for the future will always look back to the past. We see it in the Bible. The children of Israel, they were delivered from the slavery in Egypt, from hundreds of years of slavery in Egypt. They were delivered. God opened the Red Sea for them. The Egyptian army was behind them. The Red Sea was in front of them. Moses was there. The waters opened. They walked through as on dry ground. They got to the other side. No sooner were they on the other side when they sang, "Hey, yo, Mo." That's short for Moses, okay? You know, we much preferred it back there in Egypt. They had lost the vision for the future. And it's the same with us. It was the same with the disciples of Jesus. Jesus had died. It was the Sunday between Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday. And there were the disciples. And they looked at each other and they said, "Let's go back to fishing." God hadn't called them to go fishing. He called them to go fishing for the souls of humanity. And every time we lose God's vision for the future, we go back. Old mindsets, old habits, old ways. It's time to move forward. It's time for a fresh revelation of what Jesus has for you. A fresh revelation. A fresh revelation. Last week was Easter Sunday. Wasn't it glorious to gather together, yeah, in the sanctuary and online to celebrate the triumphant resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to see that when His love reigns over our lives, we know that He is King over everything. Hallelujah. The resurrection of Jesus from the dead is the proof that Jesus is King. He's on the throne. He's King over everything. He's King over what we've gone through as a nation and as a world. He's King of tomorrow. He's King. But what it's going to take is a fresh revelation of the King and His kingdom coming in power. Hallelujah. Today, we're going to continue talking about love reigns. It's the new season we're in. Are we going to be looking at that love reigns over our past? You see, too many people are controlled by their past. You love Jesus. You know He loves you. You've got no problem with that. You're a devout Christian, a devout disciple of Christ, but your past comes back to haunt you over and over and over again. And today's your day of being set free from that in Jesus' name. Right? To help me with my introduction to my sermon, and in all frankness, I could just stop preaching right now, but we're going to watch a video clip to help me with my introduction to my sermon this morning.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Love reigns, and his love reigns over our past. Many people believe that their past is a hindrance to their present and that their past is a hindrance to their future. Some people's pasts weigh heavily on them like a massive burden, like a massive weight. You know, people make choices. We've all made wrong choices in life. I mean, if I had to ask for hands up for anybody who's never made a wrong choice, you know, unless there's a lying spirit operating, none of us are going to put our hands up. We've all made wrong choices in the past. Every single one of us, including me, we've all made wrong choices. Some wrong choices, you know, they're minor wrong choices, and we still think about it sometimes, but thank God they've got no big lasting consequences. But sometimes we make choices that have massive consequences on our lives. And what we allow the enemy to do, and what we allow our mind to do, and what we allow our emotions and even our spirit to do, we allow that to speak over a death sentence over our lives, saying to us that you will never get past that moment, saying to us at that moment in time when you made that mistake, or it might not even be a mistake, when you went through something that someone else put on you. It wasn't your fault, but they put something on you. Anybody know what I'm talking about here this morning? Now, sometimes people put stuff on you. It almost feels, excuse me for the vivid description this morning, I'm going to go for it. Are you ready for it? It almost feels like they've had a diarrhea attack all over you. You experience that, and it kind of marks you. You wish that you didn't get caught up in their dirty washing laundry basket, because you're just not part of that laundry basket. Anybody been there? And what happens is we allow those moments to come in and define us and limit us in our life and in our freedom that Christ has called us to. You know, I'm a firm believer that it's not where you come from that counts, but it's where you're going to that counts. It's not where you come from, but it's where you go to. You know, whether you're born the right side of the track or the wrong side of the track, once you are in Christ, none of that matters. Because Christ doesn't look at the right side or the wrong side of the track. He looks at your heart. He looks at you, and he creates in you a whole new being. He creates in you a whole new person. You know, some people live under the sentence of a bad sex result. Yeah? And sometimes we see people fail, and what do? We apply that result as a template over their life. And we always look at them through the eyes of that failure. This is where we need a radical new thinking. Not only are we allowed to allow Jesus to make that difference in our lives, but we are to see the difference and celebrate the difference that Jesus has made in other people's lives. You may have done badly in a certain subject at school. It doesn't mean that that will limit you for the rest of your life. Just because somebody said you won't be good at something doesn't mean God says that about you. And we need to release ourselves of those things. The Gospels are full of encounters with Jesus. And when Jesus entered someone's life, it changed everything about them. Hallelujah. The Bible is full of Jesus and the triumphant cross and the triumphant resurrection. And when people place their lives in Jesus, he was different. And this is exactly where the scripture reading comes in this morning, which my daughter Rain so beautifully read to us. And let's look at one of those verses from the scripture reading this morning, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Are you with me still? This meaning anything to anyone so far? Okay, good. I'll continue. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. Let's have a look at that. The new creation has come. It is the old has. Bye. The new is here. Look at the emphasis on the new. The new creation has come, the new is here. I mean, imagine a song and you just repeat it. The new has come, the new is here. Maybe you need that playing in your spirit. The new that Christ is doing has come, and it's yeah, and the old has gone. What do you say to the gone? We say, goodbye. You're no longer part of my life. Goodbye. You're not destined to be in my life. Goodbye. The enemy meant to bring that into my life to harm me, but God is going to bring glory. He's going to bring good. The weight of his glory is going to come down upon my life, and he's going to lift me to be the person he's called me to be. If you don't say amen now, say oh man, or say something, okay? Look at that. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. Paul sets this verse up by speaking about God's amazing love that would offer the life of Jesus to rescue ours. Let's keep that scripture up, please, Julian. Doing a great job on the laptop, bless you. That's 2 Corinthians 5:17. And let's get it up. Therefore, so Paul sets this scripture up by thinking about what Jesus did, offering his life to rescue ours. Do you notice the word therefore there? Yeah, it's quite clear. It's the first word. So here's a little tip to Bible interpretation. Every time you see the word therefore in the Bible, you've got to find out what it's there for. Okay, you've got that? Okay, so it's because of God's love that we who are in Christ is a new creation. That's what the word therefore is there for. It's because we are in Christ, we are a new creation. Look at those words. If anyone is, notice two words. Two words that contain a world, a universe, an eternity of truth in them. In Christ. You're either in or you're not in. You're either in Christ or you are not in Christ. As long as Christ is outside of a person's life, they will never value what he has done for them. You have to be in Christ. This is it. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, you know, it's not enough to say, I come to BHBC. You know, when we arrive there one day, in glory, oh, I went to BHBC. It's not enough to say, oh, I love to worship, sing all the modern songs. I can even harmonize with them. It's not enough to say, oh, I love the hymns and the modern songs. It's not even enough to say you've been baptized by the pastor. You know, maybe I shouldn't say this, but I was dedicated as a baby to the Lord by the top guy of the Assemblies of God movement. That didn't save me. That didn't put me in Christ. You can have the top bishop from wherever do whatever. It's not going to save you, with all due respect. And people and ministers and bishops and pastors and leaders do amazing things in the name of the Lord. But if we are not in Christ, none of that counts. And you know, Paul is passionate about being in Christ. I mean, Paul uses in his letters alone, in Christ, 216 times. I mean, he's trying to get a message across. He's trying to say to us, folks, that the love of God reigns over our past. We are in Christ. Our past no longer controls us. Our failures, our mistakes, the worst thing you've ever done no longer defines you when you're in Christ. And who wrote this? This was the Apostle Paul. This was the Apostle Paul who hated the Christians before he was saved. He was Saul, his Hebrew name, and he went around persecuting Christians. He was doing evangelism in reverse. Knock, knock, any Christians at home? Drag them out, send them to prison. In fact, he was breathing vile insults over the church when he was on his way to Damascus. Because he was going to put an end to the fledgling Christians and to the fledgling church back in its day by dragging the Christians out of their meetings and out of their homes and putting them to death. Paul didn't want Jesus. Saul didn't want Jesus. He was perfectly happy. He loved his religion. In fact, he thought killing the Christians, he was being of service to the Lord. How does a person move from being a spiritual terrorist to being a radical disciple and an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, one of the most important people in New Testament history? Through the love of God, through the transforming power of Jesus, through Christ being in us, by not getting back into those same old comfort genes and carrying on life, by allowing God to make him a new wine skin. Is anyone getting this morning, or if it's only me? So I guess if I have to make a point this morning, my point would be this: out with the old and in with the new. Yeah, we've heard that before, you know, in a youth talk a few weeks ago. The love of God removes all your sin, all of it, all your shame, all your guilt, all your failures. When you allow God's love to reign over your past, he removes it all. And he overpowers our lives with his goodness. But we've got to make space for the new things. One of the programs I love watching most on the telly, and I do watch telly, by the way. I know you think pastors don't. But I do watch a little bit of telly every now and again. And one of the programs I really enjoy is watching home makeover programs. I love it when they go into a house and the house, it looks like nothing. Or it's a total disaster zone. And the person who walks in sees beyond the cracking walls and the old wallpaper and the old kitchen units and the mint green bathroom suite. Sees beyond all of that and can see something for today's world. But to get it into what it's meant to be, there comes a day where it's out with the old and in with the new. All the old wallpaper comes out. All the old, carpets come out. All the old kitchen cabinets come out. You know, all the old bathroom stuff comes out. That mint green toilet that you loved so much and you want to hold on to forever, it goes. Got to make space for the new. And we've got to make space for the new that God's going to do in our lives. You know, Jesus doesn't simply overlook our past. He doesn't turn a blind eye to our past. He doesn't forgive us for us to just carry on doing it. And he says, don't worry, I'm not looking. That's not what Jesus does. That's not what God does. God forgives us. Do you know what that means? That means that stuff no longer has the power over us because Christ is in us. Christ is in us. Realize we have the same spirit, the same power, the same spirit who raised Christ from the dead is in us. Christian, believer, church, it's time that we have a radical new way of thinking to enter into a radical new world. Jesus is in us. There's nothing Jesus and me together with the presence of the living God on the inside of me that we cannot overcome together. The same God who parted the waters, the same God who said, let there be light when there was no light, lives in you. What are we professing? What are we speaking? What are we saying? What are we confessing? Let's speak out stuff that is of God in Jesus' name. You see, when we confess, we've got to agree with God. When we confess, we acknowledge that our old, sinful ways, all that stuff from the past, it's old and it's outdated. Hallelujah. Yeah. It's old, it's outdated. Is anybody here like new technology? Anybody get new technology recently? When you get some new, you did. What did you get? You got a computer for your birthday. And is the computer awesome? I'm sure when you got the new computer, if you ever had a computer in the past, you realized then how old the old computer really was. Anybody like that? You know, those old computers that won't even update anymore? You've got to kind of wind them up on the side and, you know, pray over it. But it's out with the old and in with the new. Our old lifestyle, our old habits, it's outdated. I'm going to come into a close. God has the new and the better to give to us. Don't accept second best. Don't accept defeat. Be the mighty person, the strong person God has called you to be. You know, the kids are back at school. It's not easy being a young person in the school system today. Let Jesus live in you. It's not easy being a Christian in the workplace today. There's been a lot going on that the Evangelical Alliance, or some stuff going on, which the Evangelical Alliance, and you can see it on their website, has made us aware during lockdown. There's been some, what I would term as persecution against the church, against our beliefs in the Word of God, our beliefs in the infallible Word of God, against our beliefs that saints who have gone before us have lived and they have died for, which society wants to push aside. God has never been outdated. He's always been ahead. I've got to come into a close. You see, when we try to live as a new creation while holding on to the past, we end up frustrated. We end up frustrated in our relationship with God because we know there's more and we're not getting more. We end up frustrated in our relationship with others because all we seem to talk about is the past. Every time you meet, so-and-so did this to me. So-and-so, you know. I did this 20 years ago. And have you not heard? You know, to think that the verse we're reading from 2 Corinthians 5:17 today, if you're in Christ, you're a new creation, the old is gone, the new is here, is only for a new believer, is a misrepresentation, an injustice towards the gospel that is for our everyday living in Jesus. Maybe we've got to pray a prayer every morning. Good morning, Lord. Would you remind me throughout the day that I'm a new creation in you? And would you let me live like that? Empower me to. Good morning, Lord. I want to live like a new creation today. You see, we go from, when God gives us the new and the better, we go from telling lies to speaking the truth. We go from being selfish to being selfless. We go from being like a Scrooge to being generous. We go from spreading gossip to offering encouragement. And we go from burning with anger to being filled with joy. It's out with the old and it's in with the new. And our old is replaced by God's righteousness. 2 Corinthians 5:21. And I close with this. God has made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. What do we become in Jesus? Because of his sacrifice that we thought about, the whole world thought about last weekend. It wasn't about the Easter bunny. It's about the most powerful moment in human history that changes your history, that nullifies your past, that every curse in your generation line is broken in Jesus' name. God has made him who had no sin to be sin for us. He took it on himself while we were still sinners, so that in him, in Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God. This is going to bless someone right now. You see that word righteousness? You see that word righteousness there? The Greek meaning behind it is the idea of being approved. In Jesus, you have been approved in God's eyes. His righteousness is His divine approval upon your life. So really, in closing now, if we live in the past, we need a new perspective. If we live with all those things still holding on to us, we need new thinking. If we live just, I want it the same old way that we had it 20 years ago. Look, church today isn't the same as church last week. Church last week wasn't the same as church online. Even church online, did you notice it was constantly changing, constantly progressing from live at the manse to pre-recorded things to taking different approaches all the time to keep the new wineskin, to keep the movement and momentum of what God is doing. You know? I got used to doing church online pre-recorded. It was great to come and stand in the middle there, preach my sermon. It didn't go well. Preach it again. Edit it. You know, if my English wasn't too great, just edit it out. And Sunday morning come, watch it with you online. Have a breakfast with the family in front of the telly while we watch it on YouTube. It was my comfortable jeans. Last week I preached, and it felt like I'd never preached before. Because we're entering into the new. And I thought I could just take the way I preached, premiering it on YouTube, into church on a Sunday. So I did that. And while I was preaching, God was just busy with me the whole time saying, come on, it has to be new again. You in your old jeans. I sought the Lord all week for this. The last time I rehearsed a sermon was probably when I was 16. I came into the church yesterday and I rehearsed my sermon. Then one of my kids wanted my iPad. I thought, I need my notes. And it was the best thing they could have done. Because then I preached without looking at it. And the message came alive and God saying, this is it. You've got to move beyond what it was on YouTube into what I have for today. So even I'm working on things all the time. We all got to work on things all the time. Let's not get comfortable in our old jeans. So I've got to conclude. I really, really do. So out with the old and in with the new. And our old is replaced with God's righteousness. He approves of you. Let's pray together. I know this might be an exciting message for some, and this might be such a difficult message for others. Because if we're serious about Jesus, if we're serious about being in Christ, if we're serious about being that new creation, that means that we have to constantly live in that vital, dynamic, alive relationship with Him. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. And we go through the crushing. We go through the pressing. It's not easy. Sometimes when God's working on our lives, you might plaster on a smile when you talk to others, but it's like He's ripping out the carpets and the light fittings and the tiles. And the mint green bathroom suite. I don't know why I'm stuck on that today. And it's painful, I know. I know. But let Him do it, because He wants to replace it with something better. You've got to believe that. You've got to believe that we will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. You've got to believe that. We've got to believe that. Hallelujah, Jesus, thank You. It's time to get over your past. Your past no longer defines you. You are new. As far as the east is from the west, this is in the Bible, as far as the east is from the west, he has removed your sins from you and he remembers them no more. He doesn't hold a record on you of what you did in the past. You are free, you are new, and you can be everything. It's never too late. This is for someone today. It is not too late for you. If only I was 5 years younger, or even just 2 or 10 years younger, or 20 years younger, it's not too late. God can restore everything the cankerworm has devoured. He's the miracle working God. Would you commit today to living a life in Christ? I'm talking to believers now. I know it's a given that we're in Christ, but it takes a commitment, doesn't it, to living as his new creation. Would you, wherever you go, be filled with the life and the power of Jesus at work, at school, at uni, wherever you find yourself. I pray release, Lord, of your divine approval, your righteousness on your people now. Thank you, Lord. Maybe we need to be reminded by your Holy Spirit tomorrow morning when we wake up. Lord, help me to live in Christ today as a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. The new is here. While every eye is bowed and every eye is closed and head is bowed, and you know, at home as well, those joining the service on YouTube. Maybe you've drifted away from the Lord, or you've never given your life to the Lord. I'd like to give you the opportunity of making right with God. Would you join me in the simple prayer? And the simple prayer can change you forever, for eternity. Would you join me now? Say, dear Jesus, I receive your love into my life today. I believe you died on the cross for my sin and rose again from the dead. And right now, I receive you as my Lord and Savior. Let your love reign in my life. Thank you that I am now in Christ. The new has come, the old has gone, and the new is here. Right now and forever. Amen. While every eye is still closed, if you prayed that prayer kindly, pop up your hand. God bless. Even at home, God bless, God bless. All over, hands are going up. At home, if you prayed that prayer, God bless. And I pray a fresh anointing and a fresh release of God's Spirit and a fresh revelation of what it means to live a life in Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, are you ready to sing about your new life in Christ? Are you ready to sing that you are a child of God? Hallelujah. Let's sing that together. Thank you, worship team.
Grace runs deep.
Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. Now, don't forget that when the devil will try to discourage you. Now, the devil's always up to his same old tricks, but he has no victory over your life. He has no authority over you. You are in Christ. You are new. The new is living in you. And it's the same for the church. We are a victorious church in Jesus' name. The church of Christ is victorious. Next week, we're going to have Communion Sunday, yeah, and online. So to all our onliners, you know, gathering on YouTube, make sure you have something to hand. And we'll have safely prepared for you, yeah, in the sanctuary. In the sanctuary, we'll have safely prepared for you, pre-packaged and waiting, I think, for you on your seat, all pre-packaged and sealed, which a communion cup called a fellowship cup, which will have a bit of communion juice in it, a wafer on the top, all sealed, and that will be placed into another seal and all clean and everything sanitized, waiting for us, yeah, next Sunday. So a reminder to book online. You've got to book a seat, yeah. Bookings close 10 o'clock Wednesday morning. 10 o'clock Wednesday morning. So, you know, we're running, I think, almost more or less to maximum capacity here on Sundays. Praise the Lord for that. So please make sure you book your seat. Apply to book early. Okay. watching online as well. If you haven't yet joined us online, from online to church, you're welcome to. Please apply to book online. And once you've done that, further emails and instructions will go out to you. Now for the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May you know that you are a new creation in Christ, who the Son sets free is free indeed. May you know that Christ is living in you. The new is here. It's in you. May we commit to living with a new mindset, with a fresh revelation, new wineskins with new wine, in Jesus' name. Pour out your grace. Make your face shine upon us, Lord, and give us your peace in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to play out with it. We are going to. That's it for today. I think our laptop needs a bit of prayer at the back there. Good. God bless you. Have an awesome Sunday further.